One.
Ready? Gary? Precision music?
Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to begin. Welcome. Please be upstanding for the academic procession. Can we have the mic? Okay.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. That's good, Dean. Thank you very much. Welcome to this event today, the moment for an inaugural lecture. So, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, in terms of the powers vested in me as Vice Chancellor of the University of Fort Hare, I hereby declare this lecture to be presented by Professor Leon van Niekerk from the Faculty of Social Sciences and Humanities Open. He is based, I should say this, he's based in the Department of Psychology. And I also should add, it's not in the citation, in this, my name is Sakela Buhlungu. That's very important. Thank you very much and welcome once again. It's a very important occasion. Thank you very much. Dean.
Good afternoon. I'm Neil Roos. I'm the Dean of the Faculty of Social Sciences and Humanities. And today I have the honor to introduce Professor Leon van Niekerk, who will present his inaugural lecture, which is the final ceremonial and scholarly step towards becoming a full professor, which is the highest rank of academic progression. Professor van Niekerk began his academic journey in 2001 at the University of Johannesburg, and in 2015 he joined the University of Fort Hare, initially in the Department of Sports Psychology, initially in Sports Psychology, which was in the Department of Human Movement Sciences, and he's currently serves as Professor of Psychology in the Department of Psychology. Professor van Niekerk is a registered counseling psychologist and he has a keen interest in mental preparation, mental health, and the well-being of athletes and coaches. And his research in sports psychology has primarily focused on four subfields: sexual abuse in sport, the relationship between exercise and psychological health, psychological development and mental preparation of athletes, and more recently, the impact of exercise on the development of adolescents. Professor van Niekerk holds a doctoral degree in psychology from the University of Johannesburg, and he also, a year later, was the recipient of a master's degree in sports and exercise psychology from the Catholic University of Leuven. Professor van Niekerk has assumed a number of leadership roles during his career. At the University of Fort Hare, he's been head of the Department of Human Movement Sciences for two terms. He was acting deputy dean from October 2019 to December 2020, and then acting dean of the Faculty of Health Sciences from January 2021 to December 2021. He's provided consultation services to athletes at various levels and in various codes, athletes ranging from the amateur to the professional, from young to old. And his newest research field extends beyond sports, and it encompasses questions of mental health and well-being. And he's worked with groups including university staff and students and farming communities. Professor van Niekerk's contribution to academic literature includes a significantly large number of 36 articles that have been published in accredited journals, 7 book chapters. He's an NRF-rated researcher and has successfully supervised 8 doctoral students and 24 master's students. All of these features of what a full professor does and should be. Professor van Niekerk has been active in several academic and professional organizations, including the Psychological Society of South Africa, the Steering Committee of Sport and Exercise Psychology, and he's also been a core member of the International Research Team on Quality Physical Education and the Global Index of Quality Physical Educators. Professor van Niekerk, my inaugural, remains a highlight of my long career as a scholar, and I hope that yours today will similarly represent a significant marker in your scholarly life.
this possible for me.
That's it. So now the referee can continue with the match. I know my two children is also watching online. They're following the streaming, and so is other family members of mine, and a lot of friends and colleagues. So thanks for having me, and I really appreciate your support. So I want to start with a picture of a person you might not know, or you might know her. She is the very first PhD student I delivered at the psychology department at this university, and she's the psychologist who supported our Banyana Banyana team at the Women's World Cup. And she just returned. Her name is Dr. Koketyo Tsebe. She is a senior lecturer at UNISA. My second student that I delivered at this faculty is a lecturer at the University of KZN. I was thinking of applying for postdocs, but they are already somewhere else working, and other universities grab them very quickly. So I just want to acknowledge her in Women's Month as one of my students who really achieved well in the sports psychology field, and she's providing a professional service already to our national and international athletes, which I'm really proud of. So the rest of my introduction is just going to be as boring as it looks, but I did provide some form of story that you can follow as I continue with my lecture, if you really don't want to follow too much of what I'm saying. And the story starts there. So psychology has quite a significant contribution to make to both sport and exercise environments. And that led to the growth of the field of sport and exercise psychology globally. Because what psychology can offer those industries of sport and exercise is quite significant, especially in terms of performance psychology. So both sport and exercise psychology are already well-established scientific fields that focus on investigating the affective, which is the emotional, the cognitive, the thinking, and the behavioral aspects of human behavior, especially on the sport field that I want to focus on today. So the main objective is to comprehend the why people do what they do on the sport field and within the fitness industry. So if we talk about athletes and we talk about their performance, sometimes they do things that we don't expect. Sometimes they do things brilliantly. Sometimes they cannot even comprehend what happened on the day that they couldn't perform at best, which has all to do with the psychology and the psychological preparation and execution of their movements on the field. So we keep ourselves busy with the why athletes do what they do on the sport field. When we talk about the fitness industry, we're also interested in why people do what they do. Why would you have a gym membership for 3 years and never go? It's always an interesting thing to think about and to comprehend in terms of human behavior. So both these fields, sport and exercise psychology, has come a long way since the very first research in 1898. In South Africa, it's much younger. And the history of sports psychology in South Africa is also quite young. So despite the historical background, there's actually quite a large and a noticeable disparity between the current status and the potential future of sport and exercise psychology in South Africa. For the purposes of this lecture, I'm just going to focus on sports psychology. I want to explore this gap, as mentioned in the title of my lecture, that I think exists in terms of what we can do and what we are actually doing as psychologists in the field of sports psychology in South Africa. I want to just leave one caveat, and that is that I'll sometimes talk about sports psychologists, but they don't exist in South Africa. Because you can only register at the Health Professions Council as a clinical, a counseling, educational, industrial, a neuropsychological, or a research psychologist. There's no sports psychologists in South Africa. So the gap between what we can do and what we know through research already and applying it in the field of sport and exercise is quite large. And we have been minding this gap, I think, in sports psychology for much too long. In that sense, we underscore the importance of seizing the moment to cater to the psychological needs of athletes and coaches, promoting both performance and overall well-being. So in support of my argument, I will begin with an overview of sports psychology in South Africa as it currently stands, and followed by an analysis of the factors that impede or facilitate its progress. And then subsequently, I will propose potential prospects for sports psychology that can aid in narrowing that gap between the current state and the future outlook of sport and psychology in South Africa. So I will start with the overview of sport and sports psychology in South Africa. Sport has played a significant role in South Africa's socio-political history, and it was marked by historical injustices, oppression, and human right abuses during the apartheid era. These injustices have resulted in inequalities and disparities impacting the access to resources and opportunities for sport development, including the growth of sport psychology as a field, specifically in historically disadvantaged areas. The implementation of separate development policies coupled with unequal allocation of resources in sport clubs and committees has further hindered the progress of sport and sport psychology, particularly in regions where limited access to training and funding is experienced. The imposition of sanctions on South Africa during the anti-apartheid struggle also had repercussions on the mental well-being and motivation of athletes and professionals in the sport industry. Consequently, the development of sports psychology in South Africa did not match the advances in countries like the United Kingdom, the USA, Canada, and some Eastern countries. Instead, the practice remains concentrated in economically advantaged areas with greater access to resources, leading to an uneven distribution of services. To address these disparities, both the Constitution of the Republic of South Africa and the National Sport and Recreation Act included provisions for transformation and equity targets in sport. These measures aimed at enhancing sport participation and the mental health and well-being of both athletes and coaches. Accordingly, the National Sport and Recreation Plan made it a primary strategic objective to achieve its 2030 development vision. Schenker and his colleagues argued that sport psychology is crucial for athlete development, performance enhancement, and overall well-being, especially in developing countries. While sport psychology is well established in developed nations, its presence is relatively new and less developed in many emerging countries. This discrepancy can be attributed to various challenges faced by sport psychology in Africa, including limited resources, insufficient awareness, inadequate funding and research, and the need to tailor psychological interventions to suit diverse cultural and social contexts across the continent. Despite these challenges, there is a growing interest in understanding the psychological factors influencing athletes, coaches, and individuals engaging in physical activity in Africa. As a result, efforts to develop academic programs, research initiatives, and professional organizations dedicated to promoting the field has been increasing in Africa. So let's talk about the current state of sports psychology in South Africa. And I'm going to focus on teaching, research, and practice. Moyle identified three career pathways in sports psychology, which include opportunities in academia and in private practice. So I will focus on the teaching and the research and the practice dimensions of these career pathways, and I will include a little bit of what I did during my career so far. So with regards to teaching, in South Africa, the absence of sports psychologists is primarily attributed to the limited registration categories for the profession established by the Health Professions Council. And I have alluded to that. There are no training programs for sports psychologists in South Africa. I had to do my master's in sport and exercise psychology in Belgium. Like many of my other colleagues that I also know work in the field at the University of Northwest and other universities, to gain some training and some teaching qualification in sport and exercise psychology, especially because I'm teaching it and I'm doing research in it. But in South Africa, there's quite a lack of teaching opportunities in sports psychology. Instead, sports psychology is often integrated into other disciplines such as clinical psychology and counseling psychology programs, because that's where we train psychologists. Or it is also included in human movement sciences during teaching at other universities, also at this university. The establishment of academic programs that incorporate sports psychology received minimal attention compared to other countries. Furthermore, the development of these programs has been inconsistent, resulting in sports psychology modules being offered as isolated pockets of interests or interest in certain university curricula. Currently, sports psychology is primarily offered as an undergrad module within sports science and psychology programs at various universities. Only three universities offer an undergraduate bachelor or B.Psych program in sports psychology, while many others are including it in their clinical and counseling programs at master's degree level. Throughout my academic career, which began in 2001, I have been actively involved in teaching various undergrad sports psychology modules. These modules were part of programs such as the BA Sports Psychology, the BA Honors Psychology, and the B.Psych Sports Psychology at the university where I was for 15 years, the University of Johannesburg. Furthermore, I had the opportunity to teach sports psychology in master's programs, clinical and counseling programs, as a specialized field of application of psychology at the same institution as well as other institutions in Gauteng. At the University of Fort Hare, I was responsible for teaching sports psychology modules in the Bachelor and Bachelor Honors of Human Health Science in Human Movement Sciences. Despite these efforts and examples, the availability of formal training and specialized programs in sports psychology remains indeed limited in South Africa. With regards to research, Schenker and his colleagues advocate for more research focus on sports psychology in emerging countries. By understanding the specific challenges and contexts faced by athletes and sport communities in these regions, scholars can develop evidence-based interventions and strategies. One significant milestone that has shaped the development of sports psychology in Southern Africa is the contribution of pioneering researchers in the field, of which I also include myself. Since the first South African sports psychology research paper was presented at an international congress by Professor Justus Potgieter in 1985, research in the field has been steadily growing, often following international trends. Most of the research is published in local sports science and medical journals, with occasional publications in international journals. South African researchers' contributions seems highly valuable at both the group and individual levels of improving the health, well-being, and performance of athletes. My research in sports psychology since 2001 has focused on a number of fields, of which I want to just focus on three this afternoon. The one is problem areas in sport. The second is the psychological development and mental preparation of athletes. And more recently, the impact of interventions in the development of adolescent athletes. While sport is often regarded and studied from a positive perspective, because it's good to participate in sport, it's uplifting, the physical and psychological health benefits from it is huge. Despite that, the industry also has a darker side to it. My contribution to research on sexual abuse of athletes were conducted in Belgium, in India, and in South Africa. These studies challenged the prevailing narrative at the time, which focused on male coaches abusing female athletes, and argued that the sexual abuse of male athletes in South Africa should not be neglected. This groundbreaking study found that almost one in five male athletes in a sample of student athletes reported severe and unacceptable sexual advances from their coaches, which in most cases were also male coaches. And they contributing to raising awareness of the abuse of male athletes worldwide. The perception of athletes in our studies on sexual abuse relates to coach behavior that is either acceptable and non-threatening or move towards more severe and unacceptable sexual behavior. The study done in India confirmed findings from our research in Belgium and South Africa. The results revealed that between 16 and 31.1% of athletes reported unwanted sexual behavior and inappropriate verbal and physical sexual behavior from their coaches, which athletes regarded as very serious and unacceptable. The study also revealed a context-dependent or a gray area of coach behavior that were acceptable by some for some athletes, but unacceptable for other athletes. So we also have some coach behavior that we cannot place yet in terms of athletes' perceptions of these coaching behavior. The research stressed the notion that any inappropriate sexual behavior by coaches towards athletes is a global phenomenon that challenges the power imbalance in the coach-athlete relationship and often leaves the athlete in a painful and confusing state. Safeguarding and child protection from abuse in sport transcend sexual abuse to also include physical, verbal and emotional abuse of athletes. A chapter I wrote on the South African context of child abuse in sport summarized the need for structural and educational interventions to safeguard child athletes from sexual abuse in South Africa. Those of you who follow the news will have heard yesterday that there is a person that is now appealing his sentence who was actually abusing children quite severely over his lifetime. And these kind of actions and these kinds of behavior is not asked for in the sport context. But unfortunately, some of these predators see the sport environment as a place where they can execute their predatory behavior and grooming of children into sexual abuse. I was also involved in a study on eating attitude and disorders that revealed the extent and risk of disordered eating among quite a number of athletes, especially in the Gauteng area. And these studies touched on the problem areas in sport and showed that athletes could benefit from educational programs and interventions to address these issues. Much of my research collaboration with colleagues on the psychological development and mental preparation of athletes focused on teams and coaches. A study on the psychosocial profile of South African school netball players, of who some of them were in the World Cup that recently ended, found significant differences in the competitive anxiety and social cohesion of netball players across different age groups. Younger players had low anxiety and higher social cohesion, which tend to decrease with age, resulting in older netball players experiencing higher competitive anxiety and less social cohesion with their team members. Similar results were found in other studies on samples of adolescents and their development of psychological skills in sport performance. Studies on adolescent football players in football academies, first division football coaches, and more recently, the first division female football players, emphasized the need for mental skills training, which seems to be an ongoing endeavor across age groups, gender groups, athletes, and coaches. The research identified both strengths and weaknesses in the development of psychological skills among adolescent athletes and coaches as well. As psychological skills are significant predictors of the development of mental toughness amongst athletes and coaches, tracking their development from age 13 to 80 and beyond, also in other roles, have progressed and continue to get attention and gain attention for the mental preparation of many of our athletes and coaches in the industry. Recently, I started a research project on the effect of a mindfulness, acceptance, commitment approach to the performance of athletes. And the two students I mentioned earlier were the first two students in this project. So we found that the influence of a mindfulness, acceptance, commitment intervention program with male league softball players in South Africa showed how a program like that impacted self-esteem, mental toughness, and competitive anxiety of athletes positively. The study showed a significant main and interaction effect of mindfulness on these factors. The other student, or now Dr. Munnick, did his studies on rugby players, adolescent rugby players. And those publications will be published soon, as they have been submitted already. The shift from a mental skills training approach to a mindfulness approach in the psychological development of athletes seems promising. And the success of such an approach among South African athletes is already observed. With regards to practice as a psychologist, practicing psychologists in the field of sports psychology are typically trained in South Africa as either clinical or counseling psychologists and often work part-time in this specialized field. Over time, these professionals has formed a well-established and robust network, so much so that we will be launching the South African Society for Sport and Exercise Psychology fairly soon. Leading practitioners and researchers continue to contribute to the field by exploring new methodologies and applying cutting-edge techniques to enhance athletic performance. There's a growing emphasis on mental well-being and performance optimization, which is expected to have positive impacts on athletes and sport organizations alike. Gore Wheeler reported an increase in the appointment of psychologists to support South African athletes and sport teams at major competitions, such as the African Games, the Olympic Games, and other international events. You now see SASCOC including sports psychologists, in South Africa, clinical and counseling psychologists working in the field of sports psychology in preparing and supporting our athletes at these big events. However, the majority of consultations with athletes and with teams still occur reactively rather than proactively. Recognition of the psychological aspects of athletic performance and physical activity has contributed to the growth of the sports psychology profession. Psychologists fulfill diverse roles and responsibilities, including working with athletes, with coaches, with the team as a whole, and individuals to enhance their performance, manage their stress, improve their motivation, and foster their mental well-being. Moile further emphasizes the importance of continuous skills development of sports psychologists, underscoring the need to stay updated with the latest research, intervention techniques, and ethical guidelines to effectively serve our clients. Upholding confidentiality, respecting clients' rights and autonomy, and avoiding conflict of interests are essential to ensuring the well-being of those that they work with. It is crucial for practitioners in this regard to use evidence-based assessments and interventions to address athletes' psychological challenges and improve their performance. Various authors highlight the need for practitioners to be sensitive to cultural differences and to adapt interventions to suit the needs and values of diverse populations in South Africa. I also want to say diverse athletes in South Africa. One would see quite a number of strange actions in the locker room when athletes are preparing to run onto the field, especially because of superstition and some of these, individual and cultural diversity that we experience among our athletes. To effectively integrate sports psychology practice in emerging countries, Schenker argue for the development of culturally appropriate approaches in sports psychology intervention. And I must say, one of my colleagues, Professor Grobler at the Stellenbosch University, has just secured finance from the International Olympic Committee to develop mental health interventions for elite athletes in South Africa, which is culturally informed. So I'm quite excited about that research and what will come from it. Hence, it is also essential to consider the local culture, values, and beliefs when designing interventions and working with athletes and coaches from diverse backgrounds. Practitioners should understand the cultural and spiritual dimensions of sports psychological practice, as athletes often express their traditional rituals, their ceremonies, and belief systems in sport activities, creating a unique cultural environment that may impact on their mental and emotional well-being during performance. Further, researchers stress the challenges faced by practitioners in adapting interventions to align with local beliefs and customs. By incorporating and respecting athletes' cultural and spiritual values, practitioners can foster trust and rapport with these athletes, leading to better outcomes. Integrating cultural beliefs, norms, and values when applying psychological principles is crucial to enhance the athletic performance and to promote well-being. As a counseling psychologist, my own practice spans some years since 2001, during which I have worked with athletes in various sports and diverse contexts. Most of my work has centered around developing mental toughness, preparing athletes mentally for competition, and providing psychological skills training to help them cope with pressure during competition. More recently, my focus has shifted towards addressing the mental health and well-being of athletes, providing consultations and education on managing anxiety and depression. I want to note in this regard that my teaching and research is well aligned with what I'm doing in practice. And I must say, to have some exposure in both, in all three of these contexts, to have had teaching and research and practice as part of my journey developing as a counseling psychologist working in this field has been very valuable. So I just want to spend a few minutes on a critical analysis of the current state of affairs of sports psychology, which might be a bit technical, but I want to do this because it will help us to get quite an interesting idea of how we can bridge this gap. And I want to draw from critical realism of Bhaskar and social realism from Archer as the theoretical theories that is often used as critical theories in the social sciences. So Bashka introduces various underlying mechanisms that can either hinder or facilitate change in social cultural contexts, offering insight for the transformative approach to social theory and practice. Archer's work on the interplay between structure, culture, and agency can be applied to critically analyze the underlying mechanisms in sports psychology in South Africa, allowing for reflections and a comprehensive analysis of the field, which we don't have time for today. By exploring these dimensions, we can gain insight into the current state of sports psychology and identify potential areas for improvement to bridge that gap between the current status and the future potential of the field in South Africa. The structural dimension of sports psychology in South Africa encompasses, according to Archer, the institutional frameworks, policies, and resources influencing its development and implementation. Following from the discussion above, various structures or structural factors, including the Health Professions Act, the Psychology Board, the lack of formal training programs. Is this still there? Nothing there. It's giving me an idea here that it's leaving us. I'm hopefully where I should be. If not, well, we'll move on from there. So we have these structural factors that would influence the progress of sports psychology from its current state. These structures reinforce limited access and create unnecessary bureaucratic hurdles, making sports psychology service inaccessible for many athletes, especially those in underprivileged communities, due to financial constraints and a lack of outreach programs. Additionally, the bureaucratic structure of sport institutions may also hinder the efficient integration of sports psychology into training programs, leading to delayed benefits for athletes. With regards to culture, Archer argues that cultural factors are significant influences of human action and agency within the social structure. In the context of sports psychology in South Africa, the cultural dimensions involves the beliefs, the attitudes, and the values of athletes, coaches, and society at large towards mental health and psychological support in sport. Various discourses among athletes and coaches may reinforce myths and stigmatization, preventing athletes from seeking psychological support. One of the particular pervasive discourses that discourages athletes from seeking psychological support is the belief that athletes should constantly embody mental toughness and resilience. This discourse often associates seeking help with weakness, leading to reluctance among athletes to consult psychologists due to fears of stigmatization and judgment. Coaches, fellow athletes, and the media may inadvertently perpetuate this myth, fostering an environment where mental struggles are seen as signs of inadequacy rather than natural aspects of the human experience. The fear of being labeled mentally weak or unstable can prompt athletes to suppress their emotions and struggle in silence, resulting in exacerbated mental health issues and potential declines in performance. Societal attitudes, a lack of mental health education, and the historical perceptions of mental health challenges as taboo in sports perpetuate this stigma. With regards to agency, the agency dimension of sports psychology in South Africa focuses on the attention or the actions and the decisions of athletes, coaches, and sports psychologists in shaping the field and its impact on individuals and communities. Both structural and cultural factors can negatively impact the agency of a sports psychologist, rendering them less effective in providing psychological services. This includes a lack of comprehensive research and evaluation of sports psychology interventions in South Africa, hindering the identification of effective practices and evidence-based approaches. Additionally, insufficient skills development and training for addressing these diverse needs for athletes can limit sports psychologists' agency in promoting optimal mental performance. One of the first prospects, I think, for sports psychology in South Africa is youth development. To advance sports psychology in South Africa, addressing issues of accessibility, cultural sensitivity, mental health stigma, and research deficits is crucial. By doing so, the field can significantly contribute to the mental well-being and athletic success among our athletes. The prospects, as I see them, for the practice of sports psychology lies in this developmental function of psychology and sports psychology. Leroux and Lewis strongly advocate for the inclusion of sports psychology in school contexts, as there is a growing need among school children for more information about sports psychology and a desire for its services to be more readily available to them. Moile plead for a greater emphasis on mental health promotion during this stage. I think I'm a bit behind and I'm going backwards now. I want to get to this slide because in my view, and you will see there a summary in the table of three developmental theories. In my view, based on psychological development theory of Erikson, the sport development theory of Balje and Hamilton, and the mental toughness development theory of Connaughton, include the stage of adolescence as the most opportune time to expose athletes to mental skills and mental health education. All three of these development theories in sport coincide in the emphasis on psychological skills development during adolescence. During that time of their lives, athletes are in the stage of identity formation and simultaneously learning how to compete according to the sport development theory. It is during this stage of sport development that athletes require the necessary mental skills to perform at their best and learn how to outsmart their opponents during competitions. Connaughton and his colleagues argue that this stage is the most conducive for learning and absorbing mental skills. Based on this integration of the three developmental theories, I propose that the applications of sports psychology lie primarily in this development stage. That's why most of my research was on adolescent athletes. Chube, who is a sports psychologist in Botswana, also the African representative on the International Society for Sport and Exercise Psychology, has identified considerable potential for growth in sports psychology despite the challenges. The increasing interest in sport and physical activity, coupled with a growing awareness of the psychological aspects of performance, creates prospects for further development in the field and expanding the accessibility of sports psychology services across different African regions. To foster the growth and development of sports psychology, collaborative efforts and increased interdisciplinary collaboration between developed and emerging countries are crucial. Developed countries can offer expertise and resources, while emerging countries can contribute unique perspectives and cultural insights. Advancing research focus on sports psychology in emerging countries can bring understanding to the specific challenges and contexts faced by athletes and sport communities in these regions, enabling scholars to develop evidence-based interventions and strategies. This will help document the potential positive impact of sports psychology in emerging countries, not only in sport performance, but also in promoting mental health and well-being and personal development among athletes. Therefore, it is essential to increase collaboration between researchers, practitioners, and policy makers while fostering international partnerships to share knowledge and experience. Researchers advocate for the integration of local perspectives in the future direction of sports psychology. They emphasize the importance of incorporating local perspectives and indigenous knowledge into sports psychology practices. Recognizing and respecting the cultural diversity and traditions of Southern Africa are vital for the successful application of psychological principles in the context of sport performance. Hagen and colleagues suggest exploring more culturally relevant assessment tools and intervention strategies to enhance the effectiveness of sports psychology practice in this region. Ethical considerations in sports psychology practice, particularly in the context of Southern Africa, are also emphasized. Ethical guidelines and cultural sensitivity are essential when working with diverse populations, ensuring the well-being and dignity of athletes and performers. Kupu and Fortein, some of my colleagues from the University of Johannesburg, highlighted the role of sports psychology, particularly in youth development programs, in nurturing talent, promoting physical activity, and fostering a healthy lifestyle among young athletes. These authors also emphasize the significance of long-term player development rather than focusing solely on immediate success. The last and the second area of opportunity, I think, for sports psychology is in mental health support. South Africans' knowledge and perceptions of mental health has been hindered by stigmatization and a lack of resources for providing mental health care, despite efforts to perform or reform the mental health legislation and policy in South Africa. Freeman proposed alternative ways to link mental health concerns in South Africa with more accessible general health concerns and education. And since then, sports such as surfing has been successfully used in conjunction with other evidence-based practices to improve mental health here on our shores, in the harbor in East London. Some of that research has been done, as well as in the Western Cape. Traditionally, mental health has been defined as from an illness perspective, focusing on mental health disorders like depression, anxiety, and substance abuse. However, the World Health Organization redefined mental health from a health perspective as a state of well-being in which the individual realizes their potential or their abilities, can cope with the normal stress of life, can work productively and fruitfully, and is able to make a contribution to their communities. On the other hand, mental well-being refers to the thriving of individuals on various levels, such as emotional, psychological, and social well-being. Sports psychology, however, goes beyond performance enhancement and encompasses the holistic well-being of athletes, recognizing the challenges they face in terms of mental health and psychological resilience. It is imperative to develop proactive strategies to address mental health concerns within the sporting community, establishing support systems, promoting open dialogue, and providing accessible mental health services that can safeguard the mental well-being of athletes, promoting a healthier and more inclusive sporting culture. The approach to address mental health concerns in the sporting community should align with international strategies such as the Sustainable Development Goals 2030, highlighted by the United Nations, specifically addressing Goal 3, which is good health and well-being. I heard the other day that that goal was only included fairly recently, and well-being and good health was not recognized as one of the strategic goals for sustainable development. And this goal focuses on ensuring healthy lives and well-being for all, including the mental health and well-being of elite athletes and coaches in various sports in South Africa. I am concluding. The goal of this lecture was to present an overview of the current state of sports psychology in South Africa. And while it is impossible to cover all relevant aspects in depth, I focused on key research findings in the field. I argued that there exists a significant divide, referred to in my title as gap, between the current state of sports psychology in South Africa and its potential future development. By critically analyzing the current status, I provided some insights into efforts to bridge this gap and enhance the field. Two overarching contexts were proposed as future prospects for sports psychology in South Africa, which were discussed. These contexts are youth development and the promotion of mental health among athletes. Emphasizing the importance of nurturing talent and fostering a healthy lifestyle among young individuals throughout sports psychology interventions is key for me. I highlighted the need to base youth development programs on scientific evidence and best practice. Additionally, I underscored the role of sports psychology in promoting mental well-being and psychological resilience among athletes, even coaches, going beyond the performance enhancement to encompass holistic athlete well-being. In conclusion, the lecture aimed to shed light on the current state of sports psychology in South Africa and advocate for the development of the field to close this gap between its current status and its future potential. The proposed context of youth development and mental health promotion serve as crucial areas where sports psychology can contribute significantly to the well-being and success of our athletes and coaches in South Africa. Thank you very much.
Chair, Professor van Niekerk, ladies and gentlemen, another round, warmer round of applause. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, in terms of the powers vested in me as Vice Chancellor of the University of Fort Hare, I hereby congratulate and welcome Professor Leon van Niekerk to the ranks of inaugurated professors of the university. I wish him a very productive research and career, an academic career. Professor van Niekerk.
There's only 5 years of this.
Faculty of Health Sciences, when he was professor of sports psychology, have played a profound role in the grooming of sports men and women at the university. Our rugby teams, men and women, have produced Springboks, men and women. Our football teams this year played in varsity football, which is the top league made up of 8 universities, and we were one of the 8 universities for both men and women. I will not mention all the other codes, cricket, boxing, karate, and all of them. And the toughness that they displayed on the field was in no small measure due to the efforts of Professor van Niekerk and his colleagues. Once again, thank you very much, Professor, and all the best. I was also going to say that going through his profile last night in preparation for today, one thing that was not mentioned and very profound is that for 9 years, he was a minister of religion. And he also gets his toughness from that. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ntabise Ntaule Mjimba, Deputy Vice Chancellor for Research, Partnerships and Innovation. And it is my honor today to be relaying this message of support to Professor Niekerk, van Niekerk. Sorry. Let me start by greeting the Vice Chancellor of the University, Professor Sakela Plungu, and all members of MEC present here. Let me also greet the Dean of the Faculty, Professor Rose, and all the deans present here, my colleagues, students, friends, and family of Professor van Niekerk. Actually, this lecture brings us to a total of six or seven inaugural professorial lectures presented since we resumed after that break that was caused by COVID. And all of this inaugural professorial lectures just highlighted how rich our research is. They ranged from constitutional law, I remember, from management and science. We had a lecture from Professor Simatele, which covered some aspects of inclusive economy. More recently, we looked into issues of electricity by one of our professors, Professor Mayer. Yes. And then today, through your inspiring lecture, Professor van Niekerk, you are again touching on a very important field, and you're highlighting the many gaps and challenges, as well as prospects of sports and exercise psychology in South Africa. And I have no doubt that the strategies in the minding the gap that you're highlighting will go a long way and could go a long way in addressing those challenges that you have identified. Indeed, as a society, the issues of mental health remain very important, and I can even imagine how important those issues are, even in sports, which in sports are very competitive in nature, and that brings in additional pressure to players. And when you were talking about resilience and this issue, I was even thinking about 2 weeks ago, I happened to watch a match, a soccer match in Alice. And during the game, one of the sides, I won't mention which side, missed two, and I was just imagining, you know, how they felt, the people who were, you know, the spectators were waiting, abated breath, to have this goal, and it was missed. And I was just thinking now, as you were talking, that maybe, and the spectators were also waiting, and I was just thinking that maybe research should also look into the psychological and well-being of spectators. And also, you probably also look obviously into how players deal with a loss. But then I won't just go into that example. I won't say which team actually faced that. But I mean, I think you can imagine how they all felt. But definitely, yeah. So going into my message of support for you, Professor Van Niekerk, let me ask you to please receive our warm congratulations to you. And just going through your profile, I saw many accomplishments that have actually culminated to this inaugural professorial lecture. And I also saw that most of your postgrad qualifications were received with praise, cum laude. And I was thinking perhaps that was the beginning of a professor, an established professor that we are seeing today and we are celebrating today. And your career, your academic career, is marked by many hallmarks of excellence and contributions to society, some of which again were highlighted by the Vice Chancellor earlier. So as a university, we are very proud of the impact that you have made in the field of psychology. And this is actually attested by the many papers that you have published, which were not just published, but they were cited. I was looking at the research gate, your profile in the research gate, and there was that upward trend in citations. And that's where you begin to see the impact and how many people as well that were reading the work that you are publishing. Many students have gone through your hands in terms of supervision. And of course, we also look into the stamp of approval that you got from the NRF with that C2 rating, which we are hoping that after a few years is going to be a B and ultimately an A. pressure, Prof. Yeah. So as an established researcher yourself, you are a clear example of what every academic should strive to be. And we are really looking towards you contributing to this university, which really needs a lot of mentors so that we have many more established researchers like yourself. So once more, congratulations to you, your family, your friends, your colleagues, and even your students, and basically everyone that has been part of your beautiful journey. Please be assured of our continued support to you as a university. Thank you.
It's my wonderful task, end of wonderful event. my task to do the vote of thanks. Professor van Niekerk, I really want to thank you for more than just the inaugural lecture. The Vice Chancellor and the Deputy Vice Chancellor have both spoken of your contribution, and I want to acknowledge specifically the work you did in taking up challenges during difficult times for the university, of serving as a deputy dean in the Faculty of Health Sciences, and then also for the time you, I know you, when you were very busy with your research, you took on the task of being an acting dean. And so I specifically want to express my thanks to you on this achievement. But I also remember, Professor van Niekerk, when I joined the university in 2019 and took over the chairing of the academic promotions committee, it was the year that you had become a professor. And I've watched your development and growth, and as you have established yourself as a full professor, and in the very, very interesting talk you did, in the way you have presented the research and the teaching and the practice that you have now formulated and are promoting. So, yeah, preparing an inaugural lecture, I remember the task is a very unique one of just having an opportunity to pull things together and to step back and to show us something about your discipline and your interests and the work that you're doing. So I really want to appreciate that. So I'm thanking you both from the Faculty of Health Sciences, where you were for some time, and then also and Human Movement Sciences, and then in moving over to the Faculty of Social Sciences and Humanities. And I remember that you were a professor in health sciences, and then you applied for the professor in psychology, and I tried to prevent you from moving. I delayed things considerably, but you were quite determined, and you are now in psychology and really in sports psychology, and it's really wonderful to see the work that you're doing. I especially want you to pursue the gap that you've identified, but especially the gap of the Health Professions Council of South Africa and having it recognized. Sports psychology. I think it's overdue. And maybe now as a full professor you have the muscle, the status, the standing to push for that recognition, because I think as you have spoken today, it's a big gap and it needs to be addressed so that we do see many more of our sporting codes succeed at the highest levels. So I want to also thank you then on behalf also of our students, not only what the ones that you've taught, but the ones that you've also supported in sports. So thank you very much for that. So to the vote of thanks, especially to your family, it always takes a very, very a big part of a supportive family to help you to become a professor and succeed in one's career and journey. So thank you to your family and all your friends. Thank you to the faculties, two faculties that have supported you here in the university and in your contribution. And I really do hope, as the DVC has said, that you will continue to grow and succeed in your research and teaching. And also to continue to contribute in an important way to new programs in sports psychology. I think you, in having presented your inaugural lecture in identifying the gaps, I think you're going to have the challenge now to try and address some of those gaps, including in programs in teaching and learning. And I think the University of Fort Hare will benefit from innovating in that area. So thank you very much for that contribution. And then to all the people who have made their way to today's function, thank you for coming and for joining us in this function. and being here, and also to all the people who have tuned in on online and have joined us online in this in listening to the talk and being part of this very special function. And then, of course, a function like this requires the efforts of many, many people. One particular person that has to put in a fair amount of work is the Dean. Professor Roos, thank you very much for the work you've done in supporting Professor van Niekerk. And then the function itself, institutional advancement for setting it all up and hosting it. The Office of the Registrar for organizing the procession and getting us here. And then also to ICT for the work they do to make sure not only that we are all here, but that we also have an audience online. So with that, thank you very much for making this such a special event. And thank you, Professor van Niekerk, and all the best to the in the future.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Please are upstanding to allow for the academic procession to leave. But before then, we'll play the national anthem, and then we'll allow the procession to leave. Thank you. Please be upstanding.